Yeah, no, it's on. Okay. Okay, thank you for joining me in this session about migration from Java EE or Jakarta EE, if you like, to MicroProfile. So the things that I hope you will learn today is what is the exact relation between Java EE and MicroProfile. There are also other sessions about this, but a quick overview that you already know how to place it if you don't know it already. A few things about MicroProfile's implementations, overview what implementations there are available, how you can use it, but more important, as the title says, how can you migrate it from a Java EE to MicroProfile, why you should do it and how you can do it. So I'm Rita de Busser. I'm working in the service team of Payara. You can see my Twitter handle and the company blog and my own blog where I post about my open source stuff. So what are the today's challenges if you are writing applications, or maybe the challenges that you are facing because you have an application which is already 15 years old. Java EE is a code thing. You write a framework where you write applications with, and it is for enterprise applications, which is not uncommon to have created already for 15 years ago. And they are still around, updating every year with a few legal terms, a few things because you have changed a bit of your process within your company. So there are very long-term projects, still keeping around, but also popular under startups, not only for that big enterprises. Popular under startups also because, for instance, you can focus on the business logic. You don't have to worry about infrastructure. Everything is done for you, or you can have some options about things that should be different with annotations and things like that. The downside for a lot of people is that it is slowly moving because it needs to be compatible between now and 20 years, so it's not going that fast. But it has other goals, but it's not your silver bullet. Don't use it for all the projects that you need to know. Choose it wisely and then it will be a perfect match. You probably all know this, the Java EE contents about all the frameworks which in there, from front-end, ESF servlets to back-end infrastructure, security and so on, so that's probably all known. Then you hear a lot about microservices, and that's not code, that's just an architectural style, how you create your application, how you deploy it within your company. But it is vaguely defined. You find a lot of definitions which are exactly the same. And one thing it's not about, it's about size. You see the name micro in its name, but it's not about size. You can have easily create a microservice with 100,000 lines of code. It's not about size, it's about the domains. You should encapsulate all the functionality which is related to one type of domain, and it can be high level like HR or logistics, or more low level, everything related to an order or stock management. All those code needs to be together, kept together, and deployed independently of the rest. That's also a thing which is very common with that microservice. But also, it's not your silver bullet. You have a lot of, I would not say issues, but a lot of tasks to do, a lot of management, because you now not only have one application, one monolithic. The term has a lot of negative connotation, but it's not. But you have a monolithic, just one thing. With microservices, you have a lot of systems that you keep to track. You have the different services, which are mostly called by an API gateway. So the client calls the API gateway, and based on the URL, it decides which service needs to be called. These services can call other services. These can be scaled up, scaled down, can be unavailable and things like that. So you need a lot of management, service discovery, things like that. So it is hard work to have a microservice architecture up and running. And then you hear about that fat jar technology in quite a lot of frameworks, where you combine your server code and your application code in one single jar file. So you can start it up very easily, java minus jar, and everything starts up. This in contrast with the more classical things, I would say, like a web artifact, a WAR file, where you have just your application itself with or without a few dependencies, that's up to you. And you can deploy it on any application server that you want. But that fat jar technology, they say, okay, it's very fine with all those containerized technology like Docker and Kubernetes. Well, not in my opinion, because if you have one fat jar file, you have one big file, maybe 200 megabytes in size, that you're putting up in the top layer of your Docker image. So every single change in code, once change in your code, ends up in a change of 200 megs in your image, which will need to be deployed, which is of course not very efficient. Therefore, the hollow jar technology is better suited for containers where you have your server code in one file. You can also start up with Java minus jar, but you point to a certain WAR file that needs to be run. So the server code always stays the same and can go in a lower level, lower layer of your image, your Docker image. So that all those discussion about fat jar and hollow jar is about operations. How would you deploy and run your business critical thing that you need to maintain? And then you hear a lot about the 12-factor app. And that's the thing about the best practices. It's not code that you can use. It's not an architecture style, but it are 12 things that you need to take into account when you write applications for the cloud, but also for any other application. It doesn't hurt if you follow them. I don't go over to them. That's a session on its own, but I have highlighted three of them, the config, disposability, and logs, because those are the three items from the 12-factor app which are not standardized yet within Java EE or Jakarta EE. You can do it. You can, of course, define your config outside your application with Java EE. It's not an issue. But you can't do it in a standardized uniform way. The same with the disposability, so the availability of external services and your logs, where you treat your logs as different streams and you can combine them in a data warehouse like Elastic is an option. And the last thing you hear all today is about, or these days, is about reactive. And that's about a mixture of architecture and best practices, if you ask me. And it's about streaming events from producer to a consumer, which can be active or inactive. But it helps to make your application more reactive, as I will show you in a moment. All those streams are meant to be asynchronous and non-blocking, so that you can do multiple things. You can use your resources like CPU more efficiently and things like that. And if you have something like a message-driven thing, a queue, then it becomes easier for your app application to be resilient and elastic. Because if you have a queue with the events, then if the listener is down, then your events are still in the queue, so it doesn't affect the rest of your application. On the other side, if you have a lot of loads, a lot of events, then you can add an additional listener on the fly so that you can process more things. So the responsiveness of your application can be improved by that. So you see, you have all those things, Java EE, monolithic thing, microservice, what should I do, which should I choose? You have the influence of the 12-factor app, the reactive manifesto and things like that. So it is quite a challenge today to create application. And then 2 years ago, there was something launched like MicroProfile, which the idea was to add some missing things to Java EE to make it more microservice-alike. They have addressed things like configuration, REST invocation, security, tracing and metrics, because when you're distributed, you need to keep track of all the requests and see if your services are healthy or not, and things like that. Also for configuration, the thing that I said which was missing from the 12-factor app, and things like that. So it's again a coded thing, so you write actual code with MicroProfile, and it helps you to make your Java EE more microservice compliant, taking into account the 12-factor app and reactive manifesto. So I see it as the ideal combination nowadays to write applications, so that you can take everything that you need to have a success. But MicroProfile is new, so what are your migration options? Why should you migrate? Because you have maybe a monolithic application, 15 years old, 500,000 lines of code. If you break it down, rewriting is not an option. It takes too much time, it doesn't add any business value. Probably because it's that old, not all functionality is known anymore. It's not documented very well, like it's very common in those things. How can you do it gradually, so that you can decide, I'm going to split off a few things. How can I do that? Decide how far I would go by splitting it up, or maybe keeping it as much as possible to get together. So that's what we like to do. So maybe first a word about the implementations then. Because with my MicroProfile, you can create that more microservice-alike stuff. First, there are a few what I call dedicated server implementations. These are based on Jetty or Netty most of the time. So they just implement the specs which are defined in MicroProfile. Examples are Cumulus, Hammock, and Launcher, but also recently Torrentail from Red Hat and Haliden from Oracle. So only geared towards those MicroProfile specifications. But there are also other implementations, because there was an initiative also from Red Hat SmallRay and the Apache group to implement all those different specifications. And based on that, they are adding it to, for instance, to Tommy and Wildfly. So it's in the process which is going. Tommy has released a release candidate last week of Tommy 8, which also contains then those MicroProfile things. Wildfly has a few things in the latest release, Wildfly 14, if I'm not mistaken. But there are also other independent vendors like Payara and IBM with Open Liberty, which has also implemented all those MicroProfile specs and have added them to their classic Java EE server. So you have the combination of Java EE and MicroProfile in one runtime. You don't need to do anything. You don't need to include something. It's all available. It is all inclusive. So that defines, of course, our migration strategy. You can use your classic servers and maybe add a few of those implementations from Apache or SmallRay. Or you can use then that Java EE servers where it contains also all the MicroProfile stuff. I've created the demo application. The time is a bit limited to go into detail and to show all the versions that I created, but I will show you a few of them, the most important versions. And I have a demo application. Again, it's a demo, not a real world, because I cannot create or use an application which is 15 years old and 500,000 lines of code. But the idea is that you have something with services. In this case, you have an application where the user puts in his name and the amount of money he wants to borrow and the amount of years he wants to pay it back. Then you have a blacklist service who checks if he is allowed to have a loan or not. And if he has that permission, then you have that calculation of the monthly payment. So you see a few services, domains that you can see as the blacklist and the interest calculation. And you have your application, you see on the slider, it's completely on one side, it's completely a monolithic. We created with Java EE, in this case, ESF frontend and CDI services to have your functionality implemented. So let's have a look at the application, a few points about the thing. So you have, as I said, you have a ESF frontend. So you have a ESF page. It's very simple. It's just to show the functionality, where you have a field for inputting the name, where you can input the value that he wants to loan and the number of years. And then you click on the calculate button and you call another CDI beam, which then in his turn calls those two other CDI services. One is that blacklist service and the other one is that interest rate and interest service. So it is quite basic monolithic application. That interest calculation is not, where is it? My interest calculation is here. It's just a little bit of basic mathematics what it's doing. It's not a real bank account, a bank version implementation, but it shows you the purpose of this application. So when the application server is started up, is waiting. I hope that don't have problems with the Wi-Fi where it's not coming up. Let's switch that off. Oh, I have an issue with so the application startups, as I said, just simple three fields. I can put in name, value, the amount of years. I click on the calculate button and I get the results. It's of course very fast because it's all in memory. If you are a known person who is not paying his bills correctly and things like that, then you get denied from that blacklist and sorry, you can't have your money. So simple version just to show how it could work. I've created four different versions of the same applications, more or less in a microservice architecture or not, with different options as we will see further on. So the first thing is, how can we use a classic Java EE server where no microprofile implementations are available? An example, I took here WebLogic from Oracle. So you need to add them, those implementations from MicroProfile. You can add them in the WAR file, but that will not work in most cases because all those MicroProfile specifications use a lot of CDI extensions. These extensions get called by the class part of the server at time at deployment time. At runtime, you have another class loader, so you have class loading issues at that time. It can be solved by playing with that class loader hierarchy in servers, which is not always an easy task or an easy thing to do. So the easiest thing to do is just adding those implementations to the lib folder of your server, for instance, and then you don't have that issue anymore. With that in mind, I created a first version. So it's, you see, it's, the slider is a bit more to right now. I have still that monolithic thing with JSF and that mortgage service as a coordinating service. But now it calls a separate microservice for that interest calculation. And I'm using that microprofile config specification to define where that microservice that for the rest calculation is located, because between dev, test, and production, that will change, of course, and I don't want to change my WAR file within all those environments. Later on, I will also try to use the REST client, but there are other issues which we will see in a moment. I'm going to run this one because there are a few interesting things that I can show you. So the first is that microprofile version of that interest service. This is done with Cumulize in this example. I've created an API project where I've defined the interface of my endpoint. So I've created an interface like a regular Java interface, annotated with a few YaxRS annotations, so that it can be used by all clients which are interested in calling it, so that they are calling the correct, they are using the correct structure in that REST endpoint call. And of course, it will be implemented by the service here. The same calculation here is just now put in that implementing method of that service. The POM file, there is a specific thing for Cumulize, of course. In this version, I'm just using MicroProfile 1.2. There are more recent versions, but I don't need them. And I'm, of course, referring to that API artifact that I have created, because there my definition is done. I can just do a Maven clean package to build the API and the actual fatjar file. How big is that fatjar file? Let's have a look at the size of it. The year that interest jar file is 17.7 megabytes, so it includes that Cumulize server and my application in one jar file. So let's go then starting up that service. So it's cd interest service java minus jar in the target. That's interest pointer. It starts up and I can have a look with that, and I can try that endpoint with something like Postman. It's running on port 999 in this case. I have that same amount, and when I do a send, I get an error. It's unavailable. Now that IP is bugging me again. Service is unavailable. There goes my demo. It is started up correctly. Cumulize has sometimes an issue that it's not, although it seems started up correctly, that's not always. You see, I have class loader issues. Last try. Let's thought I saw again. No, you see, it's working now. My endpoint is working. I have a microservice which I can call independently. Of course, not secured. That's another thing which is not part of this presentation. I have then the WebLogic installation here. I have a WebLogic installation where I have a domain, where in the lib folder I have added that MicroProfile config API jar file and an implementation, in this case the Apache Geronimo implementation for config. So that's included in the lib file. I don't need to include it in my WAR file. The implementation now of my monolith has changed a bit. I am including now a reference to that API module and my interest service in this case. I'm using that REST client from which is available in Java EE7 to build a remote URL call and then just read the entity, so I get my information back, which is calculated by my REST service. So if I start up this one, for the end user, it doesn't change. It doesn't see the difference. That's not always the case. I will mention a few things later on. So if I'm doing this the same, I get again my result correctly back as I would expect because the service worked in a standalone modem. So that's one option that you can do, bringing in the config, bringing other things. The issues with that is, I didn't show it, but also because we are using CDI extensions and things like that, we can't inject the configuration as it is normally done with microprofile config. So I need to use the programmatic way to retrieve a configuration value, in this case the URL for that endpoint, which by default is here defined in a microprofile property file, but of course I can define it in the environment or whatever, so then I can use it I can use a different URL in acceptance test or production or whatever. So as you see, I cannot use it fully. I cannot use all the specs as I should be able to, because of that that WebLogic server is not made, for instance, to have all those microprofile things added to it. So I need to use the programmatic lookup and things. But I've reached one of my goals. I can now externalize a few services from my monolith, so that's a good thing. You can try it also with REST client, because then you can call your REST point easier. So as I will show you, it looks like a JVM call of another method within the same JVM. But you can add automatically some filters for metrics, tracing, and authentication. So that's a very nice option that you can use. The problem is that with all those standalone implementations, like the ones from Apache and in that small array, they bring their own REST client because they need to be standalone. They need to include everything, so they include also their REST client, their Java EE7 REST client, which of course clashes with the server-defined one, because then there are two things, and you know, when you have two bosses who wants to run the ship, then that never works very well. You can get around, for instance, by using the REST client that I have written in that Atbash open source project, where I just use the available client. It just checks which client is available on the server already and uses that one. Issue with that is that it's not fully compatible, not certified even, and it's just a workaround, but it works. But it's a nice one, that microprofile REST client, because then your code becomes much easier. For instance, you probably remember then in the previous example how that you can call your REST endpoint. Yeah, you see that you have have to know a lot about the things, about which parameters there are, that you need to specify the type and things like that. Now you can just say, I have that interface here defined before, as I showed you earlier. I can just say, oh, please create me a CDI bean which is compatible with that interface, and which is capable of calling that REST point for me, and I just have to call that get interest value method. So calling endpoints become as easy as calling just a simple method. So let's move on. So at certain point, you probably have all split off all the services. You have externalized them, all of them, and then you can have a system like this. You have only your ESF your ESF application, or you can rewrite it, Angular, React, whatever your choice is, and then you have your different implementations, and then you can all run those different applications with Torrentail V2 for instance, that's also a very nice option. Not going too into the details, but then you can have all those APIs created, all those implementations. They call each other, and then you can start up all those for the different services. For the end user, he doesn't see the difference if you have done it correctly, and you have the same experience for them. But you see, you have again a lot more to maintain. You have to set up more instances of your applications and maintain them. You will also see here that there are specific things created for Thorntail. As you see, you need a special Maven plugin. It's all a nice thing. You can include a BOM file, but it's a bit more away from your classic Java EE and Jakarta EE development. So then the second option, where you have a Java EE server that has all the implementations already on board, then that's of course a very nice thing. Examples are that Open Liberty from IBM and the Payara server or the Payara micro implementation. You don't need to learn other servers. If you're already using those, you can still using them. MicroProfile is perfectly integrated, and you can create a mixture of your traditional Java EE apps or micro profile apps, and then you can implement something like this, the same picture as before, but now only based on two simple dependencies. And that's my last demo. You are just using an application with the same split up, but you're only using the classic things like a Java EE web API dependency and the micro profile dependency. There are no special Maven plugins defined. There are not the API, but for instance here, it is just a classic Maven configuration file where you create a WAR file, nothing specific, and you can run it, for instance, like this. Again, you have to start up four things, but this is then the example of the HoloJar thing, where you start up your server and then say, okay, this instance of the server needs to run my interest WAR file, the other one needs to run my blacklist, and so on. So you can still use all the things that you know from your Java EE or Jakarta EE development, but you're running, deploying it in a microservice-like style. So I hope that you see how that microprofile thing can bring in some of the best practices of the 12-factor app and the microservice style and the reactive way of working. It's not included in this presentation, but it's also available. You can use it in any Java EE server, as I showed in the demo. You can use it, for instance, with WebLogic. There are some limitations, but you can use it. You can also use it for a gradual adaptation, because there are options that you are using just your code as it is and then split it up in smaller parts, keeping your original Java EE dependencies and things like that. So it is a very nice thing. The code for all those versions of the same application is on my GitHub page. I will show it later on again so that you can note it down, or it will be available if I make the slides available on SlideShare. You can also check out that REST client if you're interested in. I have 1 or 2 minutes for questions. If you like, or if you want to ask them afterwards, that's also fine. I'm also here today and tomorrow. Don't forget to give feedbacks on the session. Log in to the eclipsecon.org site, where you can give your feedback. And thank you for your attention, and have a nice stay here at the conference today and tomorrow. Thank you. Any questions?
Please help yourself to any of the shirts, guys. Or